As most of you know, this is the Brazilian entry for the Best Foreign Language Oscar. It's won lots of awards so far. It's a remarkable film. But before we talk about the film itself, let's talk about the world it's set in. Let's talk about what you needed to say by making this film. What's happening on the ground now that you're responding to?
Right. I actually made three films about urban violence in Rio. The first movie I made about this was a documentary called First One from the Floor. Then I did Elite Squad, the first movie. Then I did Elite Squad and Use Me. The thing is, you have to understand the kind of violence there is in Rio. I usually like to quote one figure that I think summarizes it. You know, in the United States, every year, the police kills about 200 to 250 people that resist arrest. And the United States has 300 million inhabitants.
Yep.
Every year, last year, I think, the Rio de Janeiro police killed more than 1,000 people.
More than 1,000.
Yeah. And Rio has 11 million inhabitants. So you sort of get the idea of what's going on. There's always been this question of why is Rio so violent? What is it that causes those figures to repeat themselves every year? Usually you have two basic answers. One is the right-wing answer, which says repression is not good enough. We need stronger laws, we need a tougher police, and so on. But of course, it's a wrong answer, and all the time that the government has tried to enforce this sort of thing, violence has actually gone up. Then you have the left-wing answer, which is there's a lot of social inequality and a lot of poverty in Rio. And even though it's closer to the truth, it's not the truth itself, because there are cities in the world, if you look at the numbers from the UN, that have more misery and more inequality than Rio and much less violence. So my question with those three films is, what is going on? There has to be something that is transforming misery into violence with a lot of efficiency in Rio. Some process is going on in Rio. So the first movie I did, Bus 174, is about this street kid that hijacks a bus in Rio. And the police, even the elite squad, they come and there's this hostage situation. And the movie is about the life of the street kid. Flashes back to the life of the street kid. And as you watch the movie, you start to notice that the state has mistreated this street kid during all its life by throwing this kid into very bad and violent institutions for juvenile delinquents, by having this kid in his life, you know, he had to deal with cops, very violent cops that represent the state, and so on. So the basic idea was, with this movie was, because the state mistreats the street kids and the juvenile delinquents, it creates violent criminals. Then I did Elite Squad, which is exactly the same idea from as Bus 174, but the other way around.
As you're saying that, though, Bus 174 is a documentary.
Exactly.
And you're examining social conditions with a documentarian's eye.
Right.
And then suddenly you have a scripted drama.
Right. There is a reason for that. In Bus 174, when I was doing the documentary, I stopped interviewing the cops. So I started realizing that the state was not only breeding violent criminals, but it was breeding corrupt and violent cops by paying very low wages for the cops, by giving them very bad training, and so on. And so I decided to do a documentary about the cops. And I started, you know, interviewing the cops, and once I realized the amount of violence that was going on in the slums, I thought, you know, if I try to capture those events on camera, I'm probably gonna not be here to see the documentary. So I said, how about doing a fictional movie? That's how I started the fictional thing. And so I got all the interviews that I did. I transcribed them. I invited a cop that was in the elite squad to work with me, and we wrote a script. I literally bought those books, How to Write a Script in 21 Days. City Field on writing a script. And, you know, some are good, some are bad. I read them all because I never done a script. But I wrote the script, I shot the movie, and that movie, taken together with Buzz 174, they're basically stating that the thing that transforms misery into violence in Rio is the state. And so I felt like I had to make a movie that would address the question why. And so that's what this movie is about. I took the main character of Elite Squad, and in that movie you saw his life in the day-to-day life of a cop, and I put him in a higher position in between, you know, the politicians and the police, where the policies are made. So he could start to understand the reason why the policies are so bad, which is basically the politicians are not really managing. The problem the politicians are solving in Rio is not the problem of violence, it's the problem of how I'm gonna get elected again, or how I'm gonna, you know, raise money and fundraise for the next election, and so on. Everything is explainable through these lenses. This is how they work. And this affects everything, including the state of violence in Rio. Unfortunately, I'm getting the sense that the politicians here are sort of the same. By looking at all these debates on television, it's very weird.
An astute observation on your part. So, once again, before we really tackle the movie itself, between the documentary and the second fiction film, has anything changed on the ground? Has there been a shift of any kind?
Right. Well, there's several changes, but I would say that the biggest change is what you see in this movie. You know, in Rio de Janeiro is the only city in which everybody knows the address of the drug dealers. You know where they are. And why do you know where they are? Because why are not they are not arrested? Well, because, you know, the police is making money with them. That's why we had more than 1,000 slums controlled by different groups of drug dealers for 30 years. And what's happening now is that some of those groups of cops realize that it's more profitable, instead of making money by getting a take on what the drug dealers make on the drug trade, it's better to get a take of everything that happens in the slum. And so that's the mafia. We just invented the mafia.
So this is so profoundly depressing that, that in fact the shift from the original film and from the first Elite Squad has really been this expansion of La Sistema, this expansion of kind of the pernicious influence and the collaboration.
It's complex though, because it's true that when you take away the drug dealers, and the drug dealers are heavily armed, they're very violent, and they're not, you know, Robin Hood, they are violent people, and they should be expelled from the slums, of course. When you take them away and you replace them by the militias, the number of murders, there's still a high number of murders, but it goes down initially. And so it looks like it's better. But on the long run, I'm not so sure, because what happens on the long run is the militia starts to be to get into the other branches of the state. They start to control votes, they start to elect people, they had congressmen, the federal congress and the state congress and so on. The militia is really organized crime. the drug trade in Brazil, at least the people, the groups that control the slums, they are not organized. Actually, they fight amongst themselves, like you've seen in the opening sequence of this movie. So I don't know where it's going in the long run. It's too complex for me to, social processes usually are more complex than we can, you know, foresee. As economists knows, they are always wrong when they try to predict what's going to happen with the economy. Same thing goes with something like this. But you know, I do know one thing. We have to reform the Rio de Janeiro police. We have to change, pay the policemen better wages. We have to choose the policemen in a better way to be more selective. We have to change the police, because the police in any state, the police is not a detail. You cannot go, it's a fact of anthropology that you cannot go from a tribal society to a society with laws and the state without some institution that does what the police does. It's a fact. The police is very important. In fact, I would even say that if you want to understand the nature of a society, one of the first places you should look at is the police and how it works.
That's very interesting. I'm thinking you're right. By the way, we're sorry that the mixing board shorted out, and so we're not going to have use of the microphones. But this is a great conversation. This is, I mean, because you're touching on truths that transcend Rio. I mean, you're touching on truths that really affect, I think, us as a civilization. And one reason all of your films, I think, are so impactful is because we do recognize within them a greater truth, a more universal truth, even though it's so specific and so really, in a way, anthropological in its examination of the particular context.
It's funny because the first movie, Harvey Weinstein had. And so when we send the first sequence to Harvey, he looked at the footage that we did this way, and there was no coverage, right? It was just this, different camera positions and different lenses and so on, but that's what we're doing. And Harvey looked at it and he says, it's not gonna work. And I said, it's gonna work. So we cut the sequence. We stopped the shoot, we cut the sequence, we sent it to Harvey, and then he never called again.
Wow. Wow.
Lula is a fantastic guy.
As is the whole team.
Daniel, his engineer, the editor, he's the same editor at City of,
yep.
As he edited City of God's Tree of Life, one of the editors in Tree of Life. Daniel is one of the best editors out there. He's like, and he's very interesting because when I cast, you know, there's a little, you know, the best way to cast a movie to me is calling the editors, because the editors know. Right? You look at an actor, he shot a movie, you call the editor of the movie and you say, you know, did you have to work a lot to get the scene? Or several good things.
We call it cutting around the performance.
Yeah, I mean, so I cast with editors, really.
It's great.
I call the editors, I'm making a movie, how about this? And editors know everything. And Danny helped me in the casting of the first and the second movie with his inputs. And in the second movie, I brought him to do second unit, to direct the second unit. And the idea was, there are several books that say you should never bring the editor to the set because then the editor starts falling in love with the certain shots and then he loses his objectivity. That's crap. Bring the editor to the set, because when you get to the editing room, the editor knows everything. He knows what you wanted to do. He's done his own shots. And like, we cut this movie in 3.5 months.
Wow.
You know, because of that.
Everyone talks about all the reviews, all the responses, some of the award statements talk about the energy of the film, that it's this.
Yeah, but we do that ourselves.
Through
the award statements. They are ants.
So, you're really doing this extraordinary, almost documentary exploration, but at the same time, because you're using the techniques of fiction cinema, you've created this life that is just so compelling and driving that really propels the story forward. And, you know, the score, the sound design, as I mentioned before, you know, all of these things are so detailed and so spot on and specific. And so how much of that is preconceived before the cameras roll, how much develops on the set, and then what you said 3.5 months to edit it, did that include music and sound and all
that?
No,
we actually, in this movie, by the time we got to the, usually when you go to the, when you do the assemble, and then you do the first cut, you're depressed.
Very.
I mean, always. You know, you look at it and say, how could I do this?
Maybe 7 hours long.
Yeah. And then, you know, if, but in this film, because Danny was in the set, in the assemble it was, we were just a little depressed. And then in the first cut, we were sort of happy. You know, so we started the sound edit and you know, the foley and everything. With the first cut, and then we went to, I think we did like 6 different cuts, tidying it up and so on.
Sure.
By the time we got it, it was just adjusting what they already had done with the sound and mixing it. A lot of the sound in this film, a lot of the things in this film come from the research. For instance, one thing that was very interesting for me is, this film has action, and we don't do CGI. We just don't have the money to do CGI. So every action we have is actually, we gotta capture on the camera. So if there is a scene in which the camera is in the helicopter and in the, there is an explosion in this lamp, you gotta get it. You're like, you gotta sync this thing. You know, like, go, explode now because here's where the camera is. So that's a lot of work and a lot of problem solving, you know, syncing actors with cameras and so on. And I figured that I wouldn't be able to do it because Brazil doesn't have a big tradition in movies that have action. And so I've called the people from the Elite Squad in the first movie, and I said, what movie do you guys like? I mean, that really shows action in a way.
The actual Elite Squad guys.
Yes, guys. And they said to me, we like this film called Black Hawk Down, which is a Ridley Scott film. And I said, fine. And so I decided to look up the guy who did stunt coordinating for the film. And it's an American guy called Phil Newsom. And then I took a plane and I came to Los Angeles and I translated the screenplay for him, the first movie. And I said, Phil, you want to do this? And he says, yes, but you know, it's not a lot of money. This is, you know, there wasn't really, right? But he did it. He took a plane and he assembled a team of American, top American stunt coordinators and people that can do that kind of effect in the set. And the working together between the Brazilian crew and the American crew, the way we were shooting with the camera and the way, and the knowledge, you know, Bruno went there, one of the guys in this film, he's done Star Wars, you see. So we saw like, whenever we had a problem, we looked to Bruno, it's like, Bruno, you've done it, Star Wars. You gotta be able to solve this. So, you know, that meeting between, you know, the Brazilian kind of style we developed coming from documentary and the know-how and the technique of the American crew for the action scenes, if this comes alive, it's because of them.
Wow. Mm. Well, that's a nice tribute.
This is an independent film. You know, it's independent from beginning to end. We sort of almost self-financed the movie. Some of it is tax shelter money, but a lot of the money comes from investors, private investors. And we self-distributed the movie. And that's important because I think Bob Dylan once said that the big media will never say the truth because they have a lot to lose. If you're a small company, independent film, and you are irresponsible enough, you can say anything, right? You just write in the beginning of, don't forget to write in the beginning of the movie that it's a work of fiction. So, you know, it's a little, it's easier for us, truly, because I can see an American filmmaker doing a studio movie and want it to go one way and the studio has restrictions, right? We don't have them. This is one thing that helps us to do this kind of thing. The other thing is, this movie, once in a while I get questions like, so, did you feel you're at risk? You think somebody might shoot you? And there's no risk at all for me. I mean, Fraga, is a real person, Marcelo Freixo. This guy, this congressman that investigated the media, he is under risk.
Yeah.
He deserves an applause because he, you know, he's actually in Italy right now. He had to leave Rio de Janeiro. He exists,
wow.
Right?
Mm.
Because there was a prize in his head,
yeah.
$212,000.
And it kept going up, right?
Yeah.
And
then he left. And then he went to Italy, which I thought was a little strange because I called him up and said, Marcelo, no, that's where MC International is taking me. They know. So, you know, there wasn't a lot of risk for me because the first movie was so popular in Brazil that when I made this film, I knew that everyone wanted to see it and that we would have a huge audience. I didn't know exactly how much, but I knew it was going to be a big film. And when you have a very popular thing in Brazil, even if it says very bad things about the politicians pretend to like it because it's popular. You know, you gotta go with the flow. And so they didn't say anything. No politician said anything about this film.
Of course.
That says a lot.
Well,
that says a lot.
It does say a lot.
Not me, you know, this guy.
and yet, Freixo, his work led to the same kind of indictments and imprisonment that you illustrated for Frog.
Yeah, one thing that, you know, doesn't come across to foreign audiences is this. There was a rebellion in a jail in Rio in which a group called the Red Commando took over the jail with the help of corrupt cops and to kill other drug dealers. An NGO guy went there to stop the police from raiding the place. This NGO guy later on was elected to the state legislation, and he started an investigation about the militias because he realized what was going on. He couldn't do it until three journalists were tortured. And then the press went to his side, and there was, so you know, it's true. The story you've seen, it's a true story.
It's remarkable. How did you become a filmmaker?
Right, that's a good question. I am from a family of a famous Brazilian playwright, Nelson Rodrigues. My godfather was Nelson Rodrigues' brother. And Nelson Rodrigues' kid. Nelson Rodrigues is like amazingly famous. I think he's the most famous Brazilian playwright ever. And his kids decided to make movies out of his place. And so I started going to the set of those movies because they were my cousins, and watching them, watching the movies later on and editing them. At the same time, I was graduating on physics, which is a good way to be unemployed. And so I had this non-job here and this thing that I loved that was film. And as most people that sort of knew a little mathematics in Brazil, I ended up in an investment bank calculating derivatives. We didn't know it was that dangerous at that time. I really got depressed with working in the financial market. And by that time I was 19, 20, I made some money and I said, you know, I can't stand this anymore. I don't know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna do a documentary with a friend of mine who was a still photographer. And he had done this amazing work with the charcoal people. You know, families in Brazil that make their living by cutting down trees, burning them in ovens to make charcoal and selling the charcoal to pig iron industries. They make iron and then the iron makes SUVs, right? And this involves child labor and everything. And so we decided to make a documentary about this. And I didn't know how to film. I knew how not to film by watching my cousins make it. But I didn't know how to film. And so I literally called NYU. And I said, who teaches documentaries at NYU? And it was this guy called Nigel Noble, an Academy Award winning director, English director, who lived in New York. And I called Nigel and I said, if I could finance this documentary about this, and I sent him the pictures and everything, would you direct it? And he said, yes, I'll direct it. And I said, okay, so while you direct it, while you are direct, can you teach me how to do it? And so I sort of like fundraised this movie, and I got Nigel to be my teacher. And I did this movie and another one with Nigel. And the movie went to Sundance, and it got awards and everything. And I thought, that's a good job. You make a film, then you go skiing in Sundance. And I'm here till today. Lead Squad, when I did Bus from 74, had 74, 80 people in it. Now it has 400 people. By the time I started shooting Elite Squad 1, it already had 250 people in it.
Then you took it to the next level, and I mean, your movie helped a lot.
And I don't know.
Influenced a lot, and we hope it will continue helping, but are you thinking about the third movie and moving up to Brasilia?
The question is the effect this had on the Elite Squad itself, on its growth, and whether he was going to make a third one and go to the capital.
The movie with an aerial shot of the capital. Yeah. Your question translates in a popular way, like, you know, you beat up the state politicians, are you going to beat the Congress, federal politicians? And a lot of people ask me this. I've said what I wanted to say about urban violence in Brazil with these three movies. I think I've completed, translating all the social analysis that I did with Buzz on 74 into film. Doing those three films. Is there a movie to be made about corruption in Brazil? There is. And the reason there is, and it's not this one, it's broader than this, is because the way the political system works in Brazil, the funding of the elections, the kind of deals that the politicians have to cut in order to be elected, with banks, with, it's similar to what goes on here. But worse, that influences everything in Brazilian society. So one way you can look at Elite Squad, The Enemy Between, is the movie is talking about the influence that corruption and bad politicians have in urban violence. But you can also make a movie about the influence that corruption and bad politicians have in healthcare or in education, because it spreads in different ways. It's not the same dynamics, but it spreads in different ways through all society. So there is sort of like a general theory of corruption to be put forth in the film. And I sort of have a movie lined up to do this, which is it's after a sentence that Lula said, the president said, former president of Brazil said. Every time Lula made something that he thought was good, he said, never before in the history of this country, that's how I am going to call my next film. And it's actually about him. Reboot.
Okay.
Reboot.
I'm getting the
drug. A reimagining. But besides that, asking about the movie itself, what kind of things you learned from these movies and from your past movies that you're going to use to make that next movie really special, because it's very difficult to do something that the original movie is a classic.
Right.
So how much are you taking from your experience, from all the stuff that you achieved to work on that one?
So you're remaking a classic, RoboCop, and what will you take from this and bring to that?
Right. Those movies, I mean, I've made several documentaries and two fictional films. Most of them are social analysis, in the sense that you break down the social process, you create characters inside each social group, you make them interact, and out of that, you sort of like have a dramatic structure that explains the social organization. RoboCop is not like that, for me. RoboCop is, but it really interests me on another level. RoboCop is a fantastic concept that is more universal than this. Because if you look at RoboCop, the original one, it's really the story of how a company takes over a man. and transforms a man in a product, literally by replacing his arms, his legs, and so on. You know, that concept of corporations taking over individuals, their freedom, even their conscience, it's powerful. And it's very contemporary and important. But furthermore, RoboCop also has to do with a very classic philosophical problem that I love, which is the mind-body problem, in which you ask yourself, because, you know, if you look at nature, any process, through the eyes of a physicist, what describes the process is the interaction of particles through mathematical laws, mm-hmm. right? But we like to think of ourselves as conscient agents. I like to think that I stand up because I want to, not because some particles interacted in such a way that caused me to stand up. So there is a contradiction between the view that physics has of us and the common sense, which is philosophers call this the mind. How do you conciliate physics and hard science with free will, with the idea that we are agents and that we have moral responsibilities and so on? One of the questions is, you start ask yourself when you look into those things is, what sort of physical system can develop conscience and can thus have choices and then have, you know, moral obligations and so on? And RoboCop talks about this. Can a computer, can a robot think? What does it mean to think? What happens when you start replacing parts of a brain with software and hardware and creating a system that is part organic and part non-organic? Now, this sounds like crazy, but it's actually going to happen in the next 30 years.
Yeah.
And so much so that people predict that like in 10 years, you know, rich countries will have no soldiers fight. Only poor countries will have soldiers. Rich countries will have drones, right? And so all those issues are brilliantly encapsulated in the concept of RoboCop. And that's what I'm trying to make. So the movie that I'm trying to make, in a certain sense, is about, it's something that is not in the first film, because in the first film, Alex Murphy, which I love, by the way, mm-hmm. Alex Murphy's, I love it so much that I will never try to make it again, right? Alex Murphy is shot down, and then, you know, you have a little sequence in the hospital, and then he shows up as RoboCop, the famous leg coming out of the car, and you see the rubber leg, and then he gets up. You don't see how RoboCop is made. So that's what my movie sort of is about. How do you get a person and really make something work
wow.
with the science that is available now?
And will they let you make the movie you want to make?
Yeah.
Excellent. a couple more questions and then we'll...
Elite Squad was in dollars, the whole process, film plus distribution, P&A, 700 prints and sending the movie out and everything, went for about $13 to $14 million. The movie itself, 9 or 8.
And that's for the second one, right?
The second one, a little less, maybe 7.
We know this movie's already an extraordinary hit. You know, it's mm-hmm. This isn't its introduction here. It is here, but
not the final cut of the movie. Was copied by someone in the company that was subtitling it. And then one day I was in my office, and then I got a call from a policeman of all people telling me, they're selling a movie in Uruguayana and it's great, it's a hit. Everybody wants to see it. And there's thousands of people buying it, and indeed it was true. You know, downloading the internet and everything. And it was like a little strange for me, because on one hand, okay, it's great, the movie communicates, everybody wants to see it, but you know, how about the money that I invested in this film? I'm never gonna make it back, right? And this was a month and a half before we opened the actual film. So by the time the movie opened, it was in the cover of you know, Veja, which is Time magazine in Brazil, all newspapers. And it was sort of funny because the reviewers, right, would write, I haven't seen this movie yet, but if I had seen, this is what I think. It was very crazy. But the truth is, the piracy of the first movie, which is a bad thing, I'm not saying piracy is good, piracy is definitely bad, helped the second movie. It did, because everybody in every social class saw the first movie. I mean, what you referred to is the Veja, the big magazine, made hired a pooling company to find out how many people above 16 years old had seen the movie before it opened, and the number was 11.5 million people.
11.5 million people saw it before he released
the movie opened. And if you went to all ages, it was extrapolated to 20 to 22 million people saw the movie before it opened. The first movie sold in the theaters 2.5 million tickets. I start getting emails by people saying, I really love your movie. I'm sorry I saw the pirate copy. Give me your account number. I'm going to deposit directly.
Wow.
Into of course I could. So we actually did something with the São Paulo Hospital for Children's Cancer, and they got some money this way. We went to the radios, and people start depositing money because they felt, first of all, they felt guilty because they had pirated. It's sort of like the movie is about corruption. I think the movie is right. Prior to this movie, I'm wrong. I gotta do something. But it helped the second one.
So there you go. So I think we need to wrap it up. This is really a remarkable film, and it's a step in a remarkable career, and it's also part of a golden moment for Brazilian cinema, I think. And I hope you're as proud as we are seeing it and presenting it, and thank you for being here tonight, and thank you for coming.